word from the Father, who himself is the husbandman. To those who live selfish lives of self-gratification, who are judging those who laid themselves down in the way of the cross so that they might labor within the harvest fields. I read to you James 5. Come now, you rich men, weep hell over the miseries that are coming upon you. Your riches have rotten and your garments have become moth-eaten. Your gold and your silver have become eaten away, and their corrosion will be a testimony against you and will consume your flesh like fire. You have hoarded wealth for the last days. Listen, the wages of the workmen who harvested your fields, which have been withheld by you, are crying out. And entered the ears of the Lord of hosts. You have lived in luxury upon the earth, and you have lived in self-gratification. You have nourished your hearts as in a day of slaughter. You have condemned and you have killed the righteous, and he does not resist you. Therefore, brethren, be patient until the coming of the Lord. Consider the husbandman, God the Father, who waits for the precious fruit of the earth, his heirs of salvation, which is the harvest of souls, being patient for it until it has received the former and the latter rains, the birth of the church and now the latter rain outpouring that will sweep multitudes into the kingdom before the second coming of Christ. You also be patient, strengthen your hearts, because the coming of the Lord draws near. So at first harvest, then Jesus comes to gather his elect from the four wind directions of the earth. And the context of this is where the Lord says, do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth. In other words, don't be carnally minded. We are yet to serve his kingdom purposes through lay down lives. All of our focus and desires and ambitions must be towards God and his purposes. Kingdom minded people. Jesus only comes after the tribulation harvest, designed through the shaking of nations to reap his harvest of souls as this generation passes through his threshing floor. Those who want to abort his harvest through the lie of a pre-tribulation rapture, are you a friend of Christ? Those who abort the road of the cross also aborts the harvest of souls, because they do not understand the principle of the sown seed. This is why so many are deceived and blinded by their own interpretations of the end times. When you follow Christ through the cross in obedience unto the death of your former way of life, selfishly lived in your flesh, then he opens your eyes and understanding of the principle of a life sown into God's kingdom purpose. It's always been about souls. Those that live for themselves and unto themselves are blinded by the deception of their own ways. The doctrine of Christ produces Christ-likeness, which means that we follow his example of demonstrated love through a lay-down life. Few obeys his commandment and invitation to follow him through the cross unto manifest sonship, not just to the cross unto salvation as a born-again baby. John 12:24, truly, truly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies, we die to ourselves, our own agendas, and we embrace God's purposes through the cross. Unless you fall into the ground and die through your own cross, Jesus said, deny yourself, take up your cross. In other words, become lay down lovers like he. No greater love is a man than to lay down his life for his friends. A commandment I give unto you, that you love one another. It's a commandment. It was never even a suggestion. But when the seed dies, it brings forth much fruit. There's the harvest of your life being aborted by so many who preaches their own shallow version of the gospel. They camp on the level of salvation as spiritual babies. They have no idea of the glory of a harvest which God has programmed into the seed of each one of his children's born again lives. We are born of the incorruptible seed, but it's only as you follow Christ through the cross that the power of the cross unlocks the harvest of your life. Otherwise you abort it, and that's a serious judgment. He who loves his life shall lose it, and he who hates his life in this world shall keep it unto eternal life. If anyone serves me, let him follow me, and where I am, there also my servant shall be. So do we serve ourselves, or do we serve him? If anyone serves me, the Father will honor him. It is the power of the cross through a laydown life which activates the harvest of the born-again seed. God called us to be fruitful. John 15, I'm the true vine and my Father is the husbandman over the harvest. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And everyone that bears fruit, he prunes, so that it may bring forth more fruit. And this is the circumcision of Colossians 2 and the discipline of Hebrews 12 of that which is earthly, fleshly, sensual, and devilish, and of self. The Spirit of God asks a question. If the church is the bride of Christ, then how can she abort the harvest of souls within a spiritual womb? Spoken of in Isaiah 66. For which she now comes through a long painful travail by escaping through the traditional rapture. That's the harlot that teaches that nonsense. The harlot church. The bride. Understand these things. The final harvest of souls are the children which are prophetically born to the union of Christ and his church, and we shall go home after the greatest sign that Christ gave in Matthew 24 is fulfilled. But he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. This gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then only comes the end. He comes at the end. God has planted so many seeds within this earth, the husbandman, the farmer, the Lord of the harvest. Do we now want to abort the harvest and accuse the Father of being a foolish, unsuccessful farmer or husbandman? Mark 4:26, then he said, the kingdom of God is likened to this. It is as if man should cast seed upon the earth, and should sleep, rise night and day, and the seed should sprout and grow, but he does not know how. For the earth brings forth fruit of itself, first a blade, then a head, and then full grain in the head. And when the grain is mature, immediately puts in the sickle, for the harvest has come. The laydown lives are the seed sown into the earth by which the Father brings forth the ordained harvest of souls. Zechariah 10, ask you of the Lord rain in the time of the latter rain, so the Lord shall make bright clouds and give them showers of rain to every one grass in the field, and I will sow them among the people, verse 9, and they shall remember me in far countries, and they shall live with their children and turn again. This is the harvest, the children born out of the union between Christ and his true bride. James 5:7, therefore, brethren, be patient until the coming of the Lord. This first comes after the harvest. Consider the husbandman farmer who waits for the precious fruit of the earth, being patient for it until it receives the former and the latter rains. You also be patient, strengthen your hearts, because the coming of the Lord draws near. The Father said to me, they are waiting for the rapture, I am waiting for the harvest. The bride shall be known as the harvester in the strength and joy of my spirit, says the Lord. And me and my beloved shall move together across this earth in the whirlwind of the dance. And together we shall clear my threshing floors to gather the wheat into my barn before the end can come. Micah 4:11, now also many nations are gathered against you. Say, let there be defiled. Let our eyes look upon Zion. This is the Lord's bride of his habitation. They do not know the thoughts of the Lord, nor do they understand his counsel, for he has gathered them like the sheaves to the threshing floor. Arise and thresh, O daughter of Zion, for make your horn iron, and I will make your hooves bronze, and you shall crush in pieces many people. And I will consecrate their grain to the Lord, and their wealth to the Lord of the whole earth. Many fail to realize that the harvest marks the end of the age in which he comes, Mark 13:39. Therefore only to this generation the parable of the wise virgins was given, by which there shall be a marriage between heaven and the earth shall be reaped to fulfill prophecy in the Great Commission. The Spirit and the bride extends the invitation to the wedding hall, so the wedding hall might be filled with guests. Matthew 22, a bride invites not herself to her own wedding, she invites the guests. The Spirit and the bride say, come. He's concerned about the harvest, yet most are only concerned about themselves and how they can escape. This is the heart of the harlot. She elevates herself. She's not concerned about God's interests. How can a farmer remove the sown seeds out of the earth before the seeds brought forth the desired harvest? This is the lie of the pre-trib rapture. God will not remove us before the time of the harvest. We are born again seed ordained to be sown into the eternal purposes of God to bring forth the ordained harvest. Mark 4. It's through the marriage relationship between Christ and his bride that we bring forth the required harvest. Jezreel means God sows. Isaiah 19. And I will betroth you unto me forever. Yea, I will betroth you unto me in righteousness and in justice and in loving kindness and in mercies. I will even betroth you unto me in faithfulness, and you shall know the Lord. And it shall come to pass in that day, I will answer, says the Lord. I will answer the heavens, and they shall answer the earth. And the earth shall answer with grain and wine and oil, and they shall answer Jezreel. Jezreel means God sows. And I will sow her, my bride, for myself in the earth. And I will have mercy upon her that hath not obtained mercy. And I will say to them who are not my people, you are my people. And they will say, you are my God. Harvest first, then we go home. James 5:7, again, be patient therefore, brethren, until the coming of the Lord. Wait until he comes. Behold, the farmer waits first for the precious fruit of the earth. So the farmer father will first gather his harvest through the preaching of the gospel, and then he comes. Be also patient, establish your hearts, for the coming of the Lord draws near. Verse 8. The harvest is the great sign that the coming of the Lord draws near. He comes not to gather his elect before the time of the harvest, only after. We have not yet experienced the glory of the latter rain through the ministry of the latter house. Zechariah 10, ask of the Lord rain in the time of the latter rain, so the Lord shall make bright clouds and give them showers of rain to every grass in the field. And then he comes to judge the harlot church, who operates out of second heaven, divination, false dreams, false doctrine. The goat herds, the stubborn fleshly goats, who pushes and shoves with their horns the Lord's true sheep. Read Zechariah 10. My anger was kindled against the shepherds, and I will punish the leaders, for the Lord of hosts has visited his flock, the house of Judah, and has made them as his royal horse in the battle. These are the sons of God. Judah means praise. Their lives become a praise unto God in the earth. Judah was the father of the royal tribe. The sons of God are born through Christ out of that spiritual lineage and principle of Judah. I saw a vision Jesus showed me of us, the sons, running with him on horseback. And he spoke audibly out of that vision, I'm coming to judge the church. Read Isaiah chapter 1. Haggai 2:6, for thus says the Lord of hosts, yet once in a little while I will shake the heavens and the earth. I saw Jesus standing in heaven in the spirit realm with a massive, massive supernatural sieve, causing the entire earth to pass through that shaking to bring forth his harvest, to clear his threshing floor. The glory of the latter shall be greater than the former, and a glorious church shall rise out of these shakings. Isaiah 6, come let us return unto the Lord. This is repentance, for he has torn and he will heal us, he has smitten, he will bind us up. After 2 days he will raise us up. On the third day he will revive us, and we shall live in his sight. It's now, the morning and the dawn of the third day, because Jesus was resurrected on the morning of the third day. It's again 2,000 years after Christ, and we're entering the third day of resurrection, by which the sons of God shall be glorified and raised up through the latter rain, greater glory, outpouring. Prophesied in John 14:12, the greater works. Joel 2:23, be glad, you children of Zion, and rejoice in the Lord your God, for he has given you the former and the rain faithfully, and will cause to come down for you the rain, the former rain and the latter rain. And the threshing floor shall be full of wheat, and the vat shall overflow with wine and oil. And he will pour out his spirit, and I will show wonders in the heavens and the earth, blood, fire, pillars of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and terrible day of the Lord comes that brings his wrath. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the terrible day of the Lord. This sign in the sun, moon and stars only happens after the time of tribulation. He declares the end of the tribulation. Matthew 24:29. Jesus said this clearly. After the tribulation, the sun and the moons and the stars shall be darkened. Then comes the wrath, the day of the Lord. So it's a post-tribulation, pre-wrath rapture. But first harvest.